On today's Faces and Places, we tour the beautiful Halifax Historical Museum. Manus Ritchie opens up the colorful and elegant world of Iranian music. But first, the Pioneer Settlement for the Creative Arts allows visitors to step back in time to a Floridian community of long ago.
Settlement is a sort of living history museum, and we're all about Florida history here, Florida history and the arts, and particularly folk history and folk art. And we have 20 historic buildings here, including our main building, which was the old Barberville Central High School. And that was the one original historic building that sort of started here at our facility, and it's from 1919. And it served as a high school until 1940 and as an elementary school all the way up to 1969. And over the years, we had a group of folks who really wanted to set up a living history and arts settlement where people could learn and share the traditions of our forefathers and everything from history and folk art and all those things that were part of their way of life back in those days. We're a not-for-profit, and we are our own ownership, but we have a partnership with the school board, and we're an adjunct classroom. So we're open daily for general tours, so we serve people, everybody who lives around the community, and also people that travel through the area. They come here, and they learn about Florida and all the old ways of the early Floridians. We also serve school children, and that's one of our primary missions, is to really serve all of Volusia County school children, as well as children from 16 other Florida counties. And we actually serve 20,000 school kids every year, so people are really surprised to hear the kind of resources that we have for the community. And it's really something we're really proud of. A lot of people are really surprised to think about what it really takes to run an organization like this. We do have a really wonderful and diligent staff of about 12 people, but what people really don't realize is that the volunteers that work at a place like this, we actually depend on about 400 volunteers every year, and they do everything from the day-to-day, helping us with tours, but also with special events. We have several large events every year that require a lot of help. So we have a lot of volunteers, and we're happy to have them.
I think the settlement really is very important for the children so that they can see what actually went on years ago. And I think they portray this real good. And all the things that we do, even the printing presses are really old, and the blacksmith shop, the weaving, everything you can see about it is really old. And I think it's very important that the kids learn how the pioneers really had to live and what they really did.
Especially for the children now, if they don't get to see the history, I don't think they'll ever understand the history. You can't get it out of a book. But you can get it from somebody who talks to you, or somebody who gets their hands blue showing you how to do it. And there's a lot of times we have things that children can do, which is a lot of fun to watch their faces. But they get to actually touch it and see it, and see what it was like.
It's nice that the people, the youngsters and stuff, know how they did things 200 years ago.
We have some. In fact, we had a little girl a while ago that was here several years ago and did this. She came back today and wanted to do it again. So we let her.
A lot of people know us most particularly for our fall jamboree. That's the biggest event that we have in the year, and if anybody's been here maybe once or twice, it's probably because they've been here for the jamboree. And it's something that is so much fun and so educational for people of all ages and from all over Florida and beyond. And they come and they get to experience all the old ways and the traditions and the arts and the trades, everything from blacksmithing to woodworking, but also the music, the food, just the really the way of life of old Florida, and they really know us for the jamboree. I became involved with the settlement when I realized really how much they have worked over the years to preserve a really true and authentic Florida environment. Their preservation effort here at the settlement has just been incredible over these past several decades. And to me, it really just hit home, and I really felt at home here. And I think what's so special about the Pioneer Settlement is not only what's here, but it's also the people. The people are so incredible here. The people that work here, the people that volunteer here, you can really feel their affection for what they do and for what they're trying to express to people and share with people. We have a lot of senior citizens that work here, and they just love working here, and the environment is just so positive. One of the things I really like to see here at the settlement is our visitors come, and they're usually all ages and families, and there could be grandparents coming in with their grandchildren, and they experience something on a totally different level. The grandparents really actually remember, you know, seeing a lot of the types of buildings, the types of things that are in the buildings, and the collections and the artifacts that are here, and they can actually relate to those. And then they share that with their grandchildren. And the grandchildren most times have never seen anything like what a lot of the things that are in the buildings, the tools, the kitchen utensils, blacksmith shop, those kind of things. They've never seen anything like that before. So it's that connection from grandparents to parents and children that is really so special. And the farm, you know, has farm animals, and kids a lot of times don't even, you know, really relate what the food with what where it came from. And then they can stop into the country store, and there are a lot of interesting and unique items there that people could choose from, souvenirs, everything from hand-dipped candles to little wooden toys that children love to play with. It's so different from what they're used to today, and they really are fascinated by those kind of things.
This is a great show. We really enjoy the people and the environment of the Pioneer Settlement here in Barbourville. It's a really nice place to come and visit when the jamboree is on, or even just to come during the week. They give you a nice tour, and it's a very interesting place.
We enjoy interacting with the public, and basically what we do is we like to educate the public and the children and teach them and also entertain them. And we just enjoy doing this because it's a lot of fun, and you get to kind of live the way your ancestors did, for even if it's only for a weekend.
Hey. Wouldn't be for the ancestors doing things that they did in the day that this Pioneer Village was established, we wouldn't have what we have today.
Thank you.
what we do here at the settlement is it's very important to us to preserve and collect and then really pass on the traditions, the history, the art, the trades, all those things that represented the way of life of our early forefathers. And that's really, in a nutshell, what we do here at the settlement.
Community is a tapestry, woven of groups with a variety of national origins and cultures. And when one of those groups celebrates their culture and shares it with us, we are all richer. The Iranian American group is part of that tapestry. To celebrate their culture, which reaches back to ancient Persia, they presented a concert entitled A Journey Through the Silk Road. The musicians perform the traditional music of the practitioners of Sufism.
We had people from all around Florida, from Jacksonville, from Orlando, as far as Tampa and some other surrounding city. They love to see their musician from their countries, especially that kind of music. They get always excited. They love it, you know, especially this kind of music creates lots of excitement. And same time, you know, this very calming. It can be both.
The essence of Sufi music is to achieve a mystical union with the divine. Sufi music is about the union with the beloved, with God. It is believed that the music is the vehicle to reach the heart and attain a state of grace or enlightenment, a stateless state, or an inner knowledge. Music is an essential part of the spiritual life and practice of many Sufis. The lyrics have been chosen from spiritual poets like Rumi, Hafez, and Baba Tahir. The evening of Sufi music was performed by the Safa Music Group, an ensemble of gifted musicians who have performed at music festivals around the world. Their instruments are traditional Iranian instruments and have a long history. The daf is a circular frame drum covered in lamb or goat skin. The tombak is a vase-shaped drum carved from solid mulberry wood and covered with tightly stretched lamb or goat skin. The tar is a plucked instrument with 6 strings. The comanche is an ancient bowed instrument with 4 strings, played in the fashion of a cello, but with the range of a violin. The santur is a trapezoid-shaped wooden instrument with 72 strings, which is struck with wooden mallets. The ney is a bamboo tube with 7 holes and played like a flute. The evening of Sufi music was presented by the Iranian American Society of Daytona Beach. Manus Ritchie is a member.
The purpose of Iranian American Society is to promote our culture among our families, our children, our future generation, and also between families. We have lots of mixed marriage, different culture. That's our purpose, you know, just to keep our culture alive. We always involve our children, our youngster, you know, in any kind of activity. We want them to know and to remember and to learn about all this culture. Beside music, the lyric and the words on that music carries, that bring kind of excitement. Everybody knows about those lyrics, about the walls. That being familiar, being able to sing with them, that bring another excitement. And again, the reason people, they get so excited, you know, just when they see the fellow citizen from their origin, from the country of origin, they get excited. They want to have a memory, they want to have their signature, they want to buy their CDs, they want to buy their music instruments. Those are all great memories for people here.
The Halifax Historical Society was founded in 1949, making it one of the oldest historical societies in the state of Florida. This beautiful building that houses the Halifax Historical Museum was constructed in 1910. It is the former Merchants Bank. The Merchants Bank was one of the first banks in Daytona Beach in 1896, the same year that the Halifax River Yacht Club was established. Construction began on the building in 1910, and it actually opened about 11 months later in 1911. All of the sculpted plaster and the ram's heads that are on the building are all original to the first building, and the antique teller cages are all original. The windows and the skylights are Tiffany glass. The officials at the bank at the time in 1950 had the idea to commission these beautiful murals that we have on the wall that were created by the Emerys. And they chose very specific subjects for the panels in the murals that related to the economy and to the area. They asked the Emerys to paint the state of Florida with the branches of the bank at the time in 1950. And so the Emerys added their little special effects to the mural, and it has little icons and little things that are particular to the area painted within the mural. And it also contains the five flags that have flown over the state of Florida. And right now it says that the total assets of the bank and trust company throughout the entire state of Florida were $60 million. We have a photograph of the murals being created by the Emerys, where they use double scaffolding to paint the murals. And the branches of the bank totaled only $25 million at that time. So you can see how rapid the state of Florida has grown. And the whole concept behind the Halifax Historical Society and the museum is to showcase the history of the area dating back to 5000 BC all the way through present day. And so the museum, the outside of the museum is laid out, especially on the north side, in a timeline that begins with our Native Americans, the Timucuans, and then transits into the Spanish and the British colonial periods, the Civil War, the founding of Daytona Beach, and all the pioneer families that lived in Daytona Beach. We have 19th century clothing, including Mrs. Lincoln's sister's dress that she wore to President Lincoln's first inauguration. It's a fabulous 1860s dress, Smithsonian quality dress. We have a racing zone which chronicles the history of racing from 1903 and its beginnings in Ormond with the land speed record, all the way through the initial beginnings of NASCAR with the beach races, the moving to the speedway, the motorcycle week, bike week, and all the motorcycle races that happen at the speedway, and the new modern drivers, which is much different than the older drivers. We have a section of local famous people, including Dr. Mary McLeod Bethune, the founder of Bethune-Cookman College. We have a war room which is a tribute to veterans, and it covers World War I and II and the Spanish-American War. And we also have an area upstairs called Grandma's Attic, which is vintage toys and children's clothes. People of all ages and walks of life love to come to this museum. Some people might think that a child might not understand a history museum, but they find it fascinating. They love it. And we have things for children to enjoy that are at their eye level. And they are just fascinated by the old kitchen utensils, by the little tiny shoes that the people wore, their gloves. We have an alligator, a child's purse in the back that's made out of an alligator claw from the 1920s. Such a totally different environment, and they're just fascinated by things like that. We have a wonderful 20-minute history movie, which takes you back 130,000 years in this area, and that's very entertaining to the children. Of course, older people come in here, and they feel very comfortable. And often, I will hear a comment like, I have a sewing machine in my house just like that. And they don't realize that the things that are of their everyday lives are now becoming museum pieces and what we call artifacts, of course, of days gone by. It's also our mission to collect current pieces in order to pass them on to the future generations. The museum has a special program on Thursdays where we have free admission, and that is so that any member of the community or any resident or any visitor can come in and enjoy what we have here, even if their financial circumstances don't allow them to come in. It's nominal charge, it's only $4. But what we get on Thursdays is sometimes groups of people, like Association for Retarded Citizens, or church groups, Cub Scout groups, things like that, that have a limited budget. And so that's a wonderful service that we do offer to the community. We give low-cost tours to other groups that want to come in here, like the Red Hat Ladies. We have an extensive research facility with our photographs, with our vertical files, with our postcards. We have videos of events and things that have gone on in the community for people to do research on. We're just launching the premiere of our newspaper conservation project we've been working on for several months, and we have been digitizing original newspapers back to the 1880s. People may be surprised to find out that we've had like 13, 16 newspapers operating here. And they're really a total insight into the life and times of the people. We currently have city directories, high school yearbooks. I actually call it time travel. Everything that we have in the museum has been donated to us. We have been the recipient of several very generous people who have purchased collections, like the Lawson Diggett collection, who is the famous model builder, and donated them to the museum to keep them for the public and so that everybody will have a chance to see them and not that we will be locked away in a private collection. We have a very unique gift shop in that, again, all of our items are donated to us, and they are our members' household items that they no longer need. For instance, maybe they're downsizing, moving into a condominium, and they have cut crystal glasses and wine glasses and things like that that they just don't use anymore in their daily life. So they donate them to the museum for us to sell. And so we're able to offer these items at a very, very reasonable price. And the most interesting thing about it is that they're real. They're not, most of the items are older. They're not items that are imported, that are mass produced. And so they're very eclectic, they're very different, and they're very dear because they once, you know, were a part of someone's collection. We have many wonderful volunteers that I'd like to take this opportunity to thank and to encourage other people to come in and volunteer here at the museum. It's a wonderful experience, and we could not keep the doors open without them. They just do everything from sweeping the front steps to winding the clock that's about 20 feet up in the air. To giving tours. We have reenactors when we have special events and when we have school groups come in. they just helped me in so many ways. I have people that cut clippings out of newspapers, that file photographs, that answer the phone for me, and all of those things that just keep this museum going. And we, as well as other nonprofit organizations and museums especially, could not operate without our volunteers. For me, the most rewarding thing when people come into the door is what I call the wow factor. And that is when people walk into the door, they see from the exterior this sort of austere cement columns, this very austere looking building, and then they walk in and they look up and they see this beautiful color and these beautiful walls and the Tiffany glass. And so often, that's the word that comes out of their mouth, it's just wow. And that's what I love. As in any organization, children are the lifeblood. Children are our lifeblood. And so we really encourage and try to get as many school groups and homeschooling and any other kinds of children's groups that they can come in. And of course, children are down on a low level like this, and that's why it's so neat to have the boat and other things, items. We've done some advertisement, but the most effective advertisement is word of mouth. And it's a little bit slower process, but it's much more effective. And that is really the way that we're trying to get the word out one by one by one. And we have been very fortunate to be accepted as one of the major attractions by the local Convention and Visitors Bureau. And the exterior of the museum is on the front page of their website, DaytonaBeach.com. And I feel that that validates us, and that validates the work that we've been doing here to make this museum a happening destination and to make it relevant to this community.